Hello, this is Pastor Woodson Moore, coming to you from Fairton Christian Center in Fairton, New Jersey. And I'd like to take this moment just to read something that I put together a few years ago to you. Sir William Blackstone, considered by many to be the greatest legal mind the Western world ever produced, said, "Man, considered as a creature, must necessarily be subject to the laws of his creator. This will of his maker is called the law of nature. This law of nature, being coeval with mankind and dictated by God himself, is of course supreme in obligation to any other. It is binding over all the globe, in all countries, and at all times. No human laws are of any validity if contrary to this." Reading and pondering this statement of Blackstone's makes us wonder where our legal system has gone. The American Civil Liberties Union, the ACLU, works tirelessly to divert this principle of the law of nature. No government should protect abortion, homosexuality, immorality, slothfulness, and waste because all these things violate the laws of nature. Let's rid ourselves of the enemies of our land through the ballot box, and if necessary, resist those laws which violate the laws of nature and of nature's God. I believe, as the Christians prayed before this last election, God gave us a chance. He gave us a president that's trying to bring us back to these very principles, the laws of nature and of nature's God. Let's support this return.
Through you, my heart screams, I am free. I am free. time. All week long, we struggle with just normal things. And some of us are probably struggling more than others today. So this is our moment to bring all those things, lay them at the feet of Jesus, let him work everything out, because he can. He can do all things. He is our King. He wants to take care of us. We just need to give it all to him.
You are my King.
altars are open. You can stay in your pew. It's your time, an intimate time, to spend with your Savior. He's here for you. Whatever you're going through, He can take it. He's got it. Just go to your knees, whether it's in your heart or literally, and just worship and praise Him.
To the cross, to the cross. time of trouble. And that's Jesus, and he is real, and he's alive, and he is your Savior. And so sometimes we just have to literally cast ourselves down before him and say, Lord, I am completely unable to deal with this. It's going to have to be you. And he'll move. He will move on your behalf.
I do want to bless the Lord. I feel joy in my heart and in my soul this morning. And I just want to praise my Savior and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for what he has done and what he is doing. And no matter what you face in life, if God is there and you have that relationship with him and you know him as your Lord and Savior, there's nothing to worry about. There's nothing to fret about because God is on your side. I went through an experience recently with my wife of 49 years. And it was to be able to bring it to you properly, you have to depend upon my mind. And that's a problem because I have a great memory, but it's too short. But I want to give God glory through all that I say and show you how God is in control. This month, the 26th, early in the morning on the 26th, Wednesday the 26th, my wife Carol woke me up and said, Lee, could you go get me a piece of candy? My sugar is low. I'll go get you a piece of candy. So I went to get her a piece of candy. I had to get her heart candy because I had ate up all the chocolate and there was none of that there. So I got her a piece of hard candy. I brought the whole bag with it back to the bedroom. Gave her some. She took care of that. And she just laid there for a few seconds. She says, at least something's wrong. And I knew. I said, now, I'm going to have a hard time getting through this, eh? So if a tear comes here or there, you'll have to forgive me. If you're of the persuasion that men don't cry, God gave me tear ducts for some reason, and it does happen. But she says to me, she says, there's something really wrong here. And it's almost like that's the last coherent thing that she said to me. I got up immediately and went to her aid, and she was looking at me with wide eyes. I knew I've got to get some sugar into her somehow. So I went to get some of the most sugary cereal we have and to give her some of that, something that's just got sugar in it. So I went and I got it for her. I gave it to her. I had to get her out of bed, and she couldn't comprehend what I was telling her when I wanted to place her in a chair. And she couldn't comprehend what to do, how to maneuver her legs off the side of the bed. It wasn't there. I had to help her. And finally, I'd get through a little bit, and she would understand a little bit. And I would lift her up, and I would. Finally, I got her into this particular chair. And when I got the cereal, gave her the cereal, she couldn't keep it down at that point. And so I called 911, and see, all this time I'm doing all this, you know. And I went and I called 911, and the operator there, I asked for him to send an ambulance to our address, and he says, would you please, he says, her sugar is low, would you take her, do you have a meter to take her reading? I said, yes. He said, would you take a reading? I thought to myself, sir, would you please get an ambulance here? But I didn't say that to him. I says, okay. So I went and I took a reading, and her sugar was at 29. Extremely, extremely low. No wonder she was in a coma at that point. She was, the ambulance came, took her to the hospital, and there was a number of issues that happened there at the hospital. They got her sugar back up, but then they had to deal with her heart issue, and they dealt with that. Well, all this time, I'm intensely, my whole thought, my whole, everything about me was, my attention was upon my wife. And it was a day later, at night, I was laying in bed, and it was about the same time, about 3 a.m, the Holy Spirit woke me up. And he said to me, he says, something that I was really odd, he says, at what point did things turn around for you? And I knew what he's talking about, what happened to Carol. And I thought about it, but it became clear to me. My memory came back to me. You see, when I went and got my wife aroused, got her up, when I got her in the sitting position, I looked into her face. And I saw death. Having pastored for 48 years, I've seen death a number of times in people's faces. But I was never brought to a position in a crisis situation where I couldn't function. When I looked into her face and I saw death, I realized I have to do something, but everything left me, my whole, it was like I didn't have a brain to function. You asked me my name, I probably couldn't even told you my name at that point. And I'm sitting there in this state of fog, and my wife is looking at me, and I know that she's dying. She's leaving me, and I can have no control over this whatsoever. So I'm standing there, but there's one beautiful thing about it. There was one name that came to me. Because my wife looked at me and she says, like in a parting statement, she says, Lee, I love you. And I says, I love you too, Carol. But then she looks up and she says, Jesus, I love you. Because now she's looking beyond me. And I said, Jesus, just about the same time. And when I said the word Jesus, everything was set back in order. Instantly, I knew what I had to do. Instantly, everything was put in order. I looked at my wife and I did not see death. I saw hope. You know, and so I was able to function at that point. When I got through that, when the Lord brought this to my memory, I couldn't do anything for the rest of the night but praise Him. I had a praise session with my Lord, lasted for hours. I sang to Him out of my decrepit voice that you heard a few minutes ago. I blessed Him. I praised Him. I talked to Him. He talked to me. I read His word. But you see, I learned a lesson. I had been taken to a point where I could not function. I'd never been there before in my life, but I was there then. But that lesson was this, that if you know the name of Jesus, and you have relationship with Him, and you know Him as your Lord and Savior, and you're living for Him, when you say the name of Jesus, He's going to put things in order, praise God. He's going to make it right for you, because you have the authority in that name. Can I hear an amen this morning? You have the authority in that name, that you can stand up against any wile of the enemy would throw against you. You can come, it would come against you, and praise God, you can stand against it because Jesus is on your side. I love him this morning, praise God. I praise him this morning for all he's done for me. I thank my pastor for this time this morning to be able to just praise his name before you this morning. I thank you for your attention this morning, praise God. And I'll say one more thing. Give my wife 6 months and don't challenge her to a foot race because you will lose. Thank you, Pastor.
If you got your Bibles, turn to one of my favorite scriptures in the whole Bible, and it's Psalm 1. I read a book this weekend, and maybe some of you who are older have read it. You ever read Hey God? Hey God by it's not a big book, but it's really a neat book. And it's about this Foglio family. They were Italians and Catholic. And Mama Foglio, well, there was some Italian family that was sent to their house to deliver the word to them. And they reacted very strongly against it because they were Roman Catholics right to the T. But anyway, Mama Foglio went upstairs and said, if this is true, Jesus, I want you. And she got saved and baptized in the Holy Spirit. And then she began to preach. She got them all down and set them down. They were a big family. And had their own home meeting and preached. And the kids got saved, baptized in the Holy Spirit. Everybody but Papa. And Papa was mean. And he persecuted her. But she went all over. They lived out in the Washington, Pennsylvania area, Burgess Town, and they went all over, Mama did, and some of the kids, knocking on the doors and telling them about Jesus and getting them saved if they would receive it and filled with the Holy Spirit. There were a lot of miracles that took place, movings of the power of God. I was thinking about this morning, and the Holy Spirit said, that's exactly what you people want to see. You want to see what took place in that book. Her husband always invited people home for dinner, and apparently their basic staple was spaghetti, and they would buy it by the big case. And so he brought these people home for dinner, and there were 10 kids, 12 in the family. And she went to, he said, put the spaghetti on. Well, she wasn't going to argue with him. And so she went in and got spaghetti, and she had like a quarter pound of spaghetti to feed 18 people. And Frank, who was the one of the boys, he said, I just stood there and watched her to see what she was going to do. And she put that spaghetti in and prayed over it and said, Lord, you're the Lord that multiplied the fishes and the loaves. And you can handle the spaghetti. And she fed all 18 of them from that quarter pound of spaghetti. And then the Foglio family all ate spaghetti the next day too. And there were a series of miraculous things like that that just brought the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit into their lives. Not every day was that way. But there were days like that. And that power, that presence, is available to you and to me. The message in tongues spoke that. Brother Von Wald spoke that. We saw the kids being filled with the Holy Spirit up at the camp. And so I would just like for you to read with me Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Let's take a little different view of this. Let's view it from the point of the ungodly. Man, there's not much hope for them. For the people who don't know Jesus, who've not accepted Jesus Christ into their heart and life, they have no peace. They have no help in time of trouble. They have no way but the world's way. And the world's way always lets you down. But for you and me who have made Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, we have a place of refuge. We have a place that we can go to. And there will be times in your life, in my life, where we've exhausted everything. I remember the last time we had to deal with the young man that had come to church that had demons in him. And we had him down on the floor. This is years ago. Had him down on the floor, holding him down. There was Clarence Preem, Sister Scholl, Danny Wright, Tim Simpkins, and me. And we were holding him down. And he was cussing us and spitting in our faces. And I'll never forget. He went to Clarence Preem, and he said, "Tonight, I'm going to kill you in your house." And I knew that Clarence was fearfully, he was afraid of the night and stuff. And he looked at Sister Scholl, and he called her a derogatory name, something that really bothered her. And I knew it really bothered her. And then he looked at Danny, and he said, called him a name that I knew really bothered Danny. Then he looked at Tim. Tim had lost his mom in a car wreck, Tim Simpkins, and he said, "Your mom's in hell with me." And then he looked at me, and he said, "You call yourself a priest to these people?" I had no idea what he was talking about. And we had done everything we knew to do, because we're pretty novice at this. So I laid the Bible on him. That didn't do anything. You know, made the sign of the cross. That didn't do anything. And we'd just done everything we knew to do. And all of us was just sitting around holding him down, and everything just got real quiet. Well, I had known in my spirit that that night we were going to have to deal with that. So I had called Art Hanna, who was my friend from First Assembly, and he was part of the men's group there. And I said, "Art, could you come down and pray with us tonight?" He said, "Brother Moore, I can't." He said, "The men's group from First Assembly is going up to Mount Holly to meet with the men's group from up there, and we're going to have a joint meeting." But he says, "What I'll do is I'll get our groups to pray for you." Well, we had just gotten, we were done. What else was there that we could do? And he was not set free. And all of a sudden, there was just an outpouring of power that happened instantaneously on every person that was there. And we began to pray in the Spirit and began to take the name of Jesus and exercise authority and dominion over that. And those spirits came out of that kid. Sometimes, though, when we've done everything we know to do, when we have come to the end of ourself, the thing that has to be done is we throw ourselves at the feet of Jesus and say, "Jesus, I can't do this. It's beyond me, and only you can help." And he will show up to help you. He is an ever-present help in the time of trouble. I had a chance to catch a little bit of Kenneth Copeland's television ministry this morning. And Kenneth Copeland, excuse me, started with nothing. Nothing. I can remember one of his teachings. He said, "It took all the faith I had to believe for a pair of new socks." But as he fully obeyed God, would not be moved off the truth of God's word, and continued faithfully to preach that truth, God continued to bless him, step by step by step. Years ago, I had the kids, we were down in just north of Dallas, Texas, at Northern Arizona University for International Convention. I said, we're so close, let's just go out there and see Copeland's place. It's called Eagle Mountain. And so we drive out there, and I'm searching, where's the mountain? And there wasn't a mountain, it was just kind of like a flat plain, and it had a big cliff that dropped off. And God had given him this, and they just built their new big headquarters facility. They were taking us around saying, all this rock that was here was quarried out of the mountains of Arkansas and was brought over to this building. And as I'm going through it, I'm thinking, how can anybody say that faith doesn't work when it's right here before you? It reminded me of the time that Danny Wright and I were out at Oral Roberts University for a seminar with his partners. And Oral was teaching on seed time and harvest. He was the person that the Lord really opened that up to, and was the first that I know of that really taught seed time and harvest. Sow and you'll reap. And he said, if you don't believe that seed time harvest works, he said, put your hands on the front of the seat in front of you. And this was in Maybe Center, this big, beautiful field house that they had built. And he said, that's where that seat came from. It came from us sowing and people sowing into our ministry. Those principles work for individuals, and those principles work for groups, and those principles will work collectively for any church, any organization that will apply them. Seed time and harvest. The sad thing is, you know these things. The world doesn't have a clue. People just go drifting along, being smashed by demonic powers, having their lives torn to pieces, their minds confused, no peace. But that truth is deposited in you. I believe that there is coming a great revival. And I believe that you will be the instruments of taking that word to the lost. Their hearts will be open, they'll be receptive, and you can lead them to the Lord. Jesus wants to flow through you. He doesn't just want to flow through Kenneth Copeland or John Hagee or a pastor. He wants to flow through you, and he will honor you. And I've noticed that there's a shift in the workings of God in this place. I think he's wanting to demonstrate his power through you as the body of Christ more than through me as the pastor. He's wanting you to be used. And there's nothing like the joy of the Lord to lay hands on somebody and see them recover. See the power of God set them free. See them get baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's for you. But all these poor people that are lost, and many of them will almost hate you for delivering to them the message. But the secret of Mama Foglio was, she never gave up. She never stopped praying. She never stopped praying for her kids, for those that she loved and cared for. And every situation, ultimately the Lord broke through and set people free. Amen. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your truth. I thank you for this place. I thank you for your people. And we are thankful that you entered into covenant with us, that we have an everlasting covenant that can never be taken away. And now as we approach this time, will we celebrate that covenant, cleanse us, speak to our hearts, and if your spirit finds any evil thing within us, cause it to manifest so that we might repent and make it right, so that we may partake of your table worthily in the grace and the freedom that you purchased for us on the cross. Thank you, Jesus.
Hello, this is Pastor Woodson Moore from Fairton Christian Center. And we just want to take some time and go over some of the very, very critical issues for you, for your family. And one of those happens to be salvation. We hear people talking all the time about Jesus saves and are you saved? And what exactly is it that they're talking about? We use terminology many times that we just use it and we don't know what it actually means. So we want to do a three-part series here where we talk about salvation and its importance and how to obtain it and what to do with it after you have it. But today we want to deal with what is salvation. Now Jesus came into this world to save us. That was his purpose. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him might not perish, but would have everlasting life. And to be saved, the word in itself in the Greek language has many definitions. It means to be defended. It means to be healed. It means to be protected and kept and to restored to an original condition. That original condition we find described in the Bible in the Garden of Eden. God walked with man, he talked with man, he loved man, he put him into a perfect setting where all of his needs were supplied. There's a scripture in the New Testament that says that my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. Now sometimes our mind gets a little confused as to what our needs are. We think, well, if I have $10 million, well, my needs will be met. Well, that's not necessarily true. Our needs have to deal with safety. It has to deal with belonging and being loved and being secure and to be able to be successful at what we do and to have people that care for us and to have our life used in a way that it will fulfill us as well as ministering to the needs of others. Jesus came to save us, to restore us, to bring us back to our original condition. And when you think about those needs that we have, every one of them is promised to be met for those who have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. I would like to encourage you to think life through. You know, we don't think a lot. In fact, we do everything we can sometimes to prevent having to think. We have music piped into our ears, we're watching television, we're doing a variety of things to keep our mind occupied. But there are those times when we sit down, it's just us, and in Psalms it's called Selah. Pause and calmly think of this. I want you to think about where you came from, where you go when you depart this life. We've all been to funerals of loved ones. What was that? That was in that person's body that left. Well, it was the spirit. It was the soul, which is eternal. And Jesus came to give us eternal life. He would not have us perish. There is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. And I want to encourage you to move in to the salvation which is freely provided. It's already been purchased. Jesus has gone to the cross and taken your sins so that you might become the righteousness of God in him. And that salvation, that saving, that defense, that provision, it's available for you and is found throughout the Bible as you read the covenant and will of God. It is with his will that none should perish, but that all should come to the knowledge of the truth. It is God's will that you would be saved. Now the new question would become, how do I get saved? If this package of salvation that Jesus purchased for me on the cross is free, it's available to all, then how do I possess it? How do I get, in terms that you probably heard, born again? Nicodemus came to Jesus. Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He was a teacher of the people. And he was talking to Jesus about eternity and about how to be saved and the kingdom of God. And Jesus said to him, Nicodemus, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Well, what exactly does that mean to be born again? Well, Jesus in other teachings said that he compared being born again to having a new wineskin. He said you can't put new wine in an old wineskin because if you do, it'll burst, it'll break. But you can put that new wine into a new wineskin or a wineskin that's been restored. And that's exactly what happens to us when we become born again. Jesus creates within us a new man, a new spirit, a new wine sack that he can pour the spirit and the new wine of God into our lives. Now in Romans chapter 10, it says, if we will believe in our heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, and if we will confess him with our mouth as our Lord and Savior, we will be saved. The Bible also says anybody that believes on Jesus will be saved. You say, well, I don't necessarily want to believe on Jesus. I think I want to believe on Buddha, or I want to believe on Muhammad, or I want to believe in the earth and the unity of all creation. I want to believe that. Now, the Bible says there's only one name under heaven and earth by which a man can be saved, and that was the sinless Lamb of God that was slain from the foundations of the world so that you and I could walk into the freedom of the new birth. And it is obtained, just like Romans 10 says, believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, that he was the propitiation for our sins, that his blood initiated a new covenant that brings with it a new birth, brings with it the salvation of God, brings with it the blessings of God that we can have by the grace that God has given to us through faith in the finished work. Believe that God has raised Jesus from the dead and then confess him with your mouth as your Lord and Savior. You say, what does that mean? It means just what it says, that if you will confess Jesus Christ like this, Jesus, I accept you today as my Lord and my Savior. I do believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. I do believe that you're coming again. I believe that. Maybe my mind is confused about it, but in my heart, I believe. It says if we will believe in our heart, there's a difference between our heart and our mind. Our mind can be confused. It can be played with. But in our heart, deep in our heart, we know that there's a God. We know that we are eternal, and we know that Jesus is alive. So confess him and believe, and you will be saved. Then what am I to do after I am born again? The Bible says that God will set the solitary into a family. I know there's an old song that says, me and God, we got our own thing going. But God made us to be gregarious. He made us to want to be around other people. It is not a natural thing for someone to want to be a loner, to not to have other people in their life. And when we become born again, when we become saved, when we receive the salvation of God, the Spirit of God within us causes us to yearn for fellowship. The Bible says, by this shall you all men know that you are my disciples, by their love one for another. Well, how are you going to love somebody if you're not around them, if you're not interacting with them? The truth is that the Lord does take you as an individual and he sets you into a body of believers, which is part of the total body of Christ found throughout the world. There are all kinds of churches, but what you need to look for is a church where the full gospel is preached, where the truth is not denied, that Jesus Christ is lifted up. He said, if I be lifted up, then I will draw all men unto me, and that there is no compromise to the principles laid down in God's Word. Now this you need to pray over, but you need to find a church and become part of a body. In Romans chapter 12,
And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it talks of different gifts that God has given to His body. You have some of those gifts. At the time of the new birth, God will cause those gifts to come alive. And they're only going to find the totality of their fulfillment as you minister within the body of Christ. So find the church and then begin to do what the Bible says to do. Your life is important. There'll never be anybody else like you again. And you will be used of God to help set people free, to help minister the love of Jesus to people, and to encourage others to develop their own spiritual life. But you'll find the fulfillment that you're looking for by finding a church body into which you can give. Several years ago, I was preparing a Christmas message, and the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, there is no living without giving. And first it sounded kind of simple, but then I began to think about that more and more. You know, God so loved the world that He gave. In the beginning, God gave of His power and of His word and created everything that there is. There literally is no living to the fullness without giving. Jesus said, I came so that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly, that a life could be filled with goodness and joy and peace and happiness. You're only going to find that total fulfillment after you've been saved, after you've been born again, by giving of yourself and that which God has put in you to others. If you'll begin to give, you will begin to live.